If you think back carefully through the derivative rules as we were going through and learning them one at a time, what you'll realize, and it was kind of subtle at the time, was that normally we were differentiating functions. All the rules were geared towards differentiating functions. Just for instance, think of the sum and difference rule. If you look back at that rule, it says that the derivative of f of x plus g of x is f prime plus or minus g prime. And so that's kind of a subtle thing that they slipped in there, that you had an f of x and you had a g of x. But the question is, what if our equation is not a function? Then what do we do, even notation wise? For instance, we had f of x, and when we took its derivative, we got f prime of x. Or when we had y as a function of x, we would say y prime, or we would say dy dx, one of those two notations. But both of those, if it's f of x or y of x, there, if it's a function of x, then we have these notations that kind of hint at differentiating functions. Now, to answer that, let's remind ourselves what is a function, so that we can kind of help understand what to do if our equation does not represent a function. So let's just recap. This is, from a college algebra type level class. We would say that a graph here represents a function if it passes the blank. Hopefully we know the answer to this. The answer is the vertical line test. So hopefully you're familiar with that test. If you're not, you can obviously watch a video on it. But basically what it says is that if you are able to pass a vertical line from left to right across the graph, and it crosses at most one time, then your graph is a function. Every x value can only be associated with one particular y value, and that's at the heart of the vertical line test. So if you look at this graph here, that would be a function, right? Because it crosses once, 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 once. Something that would not be a function would be something kind of like this. You see, at some point it crosses not once, but not two times, but three times. So that would not be a function. Now, algebraically, what's the connection there? I don't know if that was hidden behind my picture in picture, but there's that graph there. What is this vertical line test associated to algebraically? Well, let's see here. Normally, this is what happens. Y is written explicitly in terms of x. And so if we look at some examples, you'll see the things that pass the vertical line test, the things that have graphs that pass the vertical line test, is a some format of y equals, and then you have your x's. And I'll explain that connection in just a second. Let's just look at these well-known functions here. Y equals x squared. Obviously, that's a function. But the reason it is that, I'm connecting this concept to the graph of x squared here, is that when you plug in an x, you're getting just a single y. You're immediately getting what that y is. You plug in an x value, and out comes your y value. Period. It's not, this is your y, and also this is your y. Just you get one y value. So this is a function. Y equals sine x. Y is an explicit function of x. Plug in your x, you get your y value. That's a function of x. Third equation, this cubic equation, y is written explicitly in terms of x, just in terms of x, not otherwise. Function, and last one's also a function. All right, contrast that with x squared plus y squared equals 9. Now, most of you guys should know what that gives you the graph of. Hopefully, we know this. This is the equation of a circle. X squared plus y squared equals r squared. It's a very well-known formula there. So if you had a circle of radius 3, then obviously this does not pass the vertical line test. But that being said, are you telling me then that If I picked a point somewhere around the circle that its tangent line at that point doesn't have a slope? No, of course it does. I mean, we can see it on the graph here. This tangent line has a slope. This tangent line has a slope. It still has slope around the circle, but my traditional derivative rules would not lead me to be able to find those. So how do we differentiate things like this that would not be a function? Well, the answer is implicit differentiation. Not explicit, not your normal traditional rules, is implicit differentiation. This is for equations that are written implicitly in terms of x and y. Okay, to explain how to do differentiation, I'm actually going to go back to our original derivative rules, and here's the way I like to explain this. Let's differentiate x cubed, but we're gonna extremely overanalyze this thing. Obviously, the derivative of x cubed is 3x squared. We all know that, but let's do this as thoroughly and probably overly thoroughly as we possibly can. I'm actually going to use the chain rule for this. Now, I know it's not really a chain rule problem by any stretch, but let's take it closely. Take it slowly. All right, x cubed. If we differentiated this with respect to x, power rule, the 3 would come down. The 3 would come down. X to the second, right? 3x to the second. We subtract 1 from the exponent. Now, I know it sounded weird when I said chain rule, but just go with me for a minute. If you focus on the inside now, the inside just being the x and the x alone, we would differentiate x with respect to x. Now, I know that looks strange. We've never done that before, and we're not going to continue to do this, but I wrote that just to illustrate a point here. Dx over dx, the derivative of x with respect to x. We should see that this is 1. This would go away. This expression would be equivalent to the number 1 there. And we would get our well-known 3x squared, of course. Okay. Now, why do I explain it like that? Well, let's go now and try to differentiate 5y squared with respect to x. See, that's at the heart of implicit differentiation. Differentiating one variable with respect to a different variable. This concept will be really important when we get to like related rates type problems. This will be very helpful. But in any case, if I gave this to a student before ever discussing implicit differentiation and asked them what I thought, what they thought the derivative of 5y squared would be, and they would all probably say 10y. And that's half right. 10y. But if we super overanalyze this one more time, think of it like the chain rule. Bring the 2 down. 2 times 5 is 10. Y to the first. Followed by the derivative of the inside with respect to x, we would have dy dx. And you notice this time it does not cancel, so it'll actually stick around. So here's the moral of the story. Whenever you're differentiating terms that have just an x, you just do the derivative rules as we're accustomed to doing. But when we differentiate a term that has a y, then we leave what I like to call a residue, a leftover dy dx when we differentiate terms with y with respect to x. Okay, so let's try one here. Well, actually, but before we try one, let me run down a couple quick just steps to think about. If you don't understand all these right this second, it's fine. But what we're going to do is when we get an equation defined implicitly, we're just going to differentiate both sides, left side and right side. Now, in doing that, you're going to get dy dx's maybe even more than one. So when you get maybe 2, maybe 3, maybe 4 dy dx's, we're going to take those and put them on one side, and the terms without dy dx and put them on the other side of the equal sign. So kind of sorting them, separating them. Let's just say arbitrarily say they go on the left. Well, then on the left-hand side, every term on the left will have a dy dx. That makes it a common factor. So you can factor the dy dx out. And then the last step, instead of seeing 2 or 3 or 4 dy dx, is you should just be seeing 1 because you factored it out. So the last step is to divide those leftovers away to the right-hand side. In other words, solve for dy dx. So if you didn't catch all that, it's okay. We're going to do an example here. This is obviously defined implicitly. So we're going to do those steps I mentioned earlier. All right, this is going to need the product rule. Derivative of the first times the second. Now notice I did not need a dy dx here because I didn't differentiate the y. I differentiated the 3x squared. All right, plus the first times the derivative of the second, that's 1 dy dx, right, minus derivative of 5y squared is 10y dy dx equals cosine x. A lot of students forget the other side. They'll differentiate the side with the y's, but forget to differentiate the right side that just has constants or not many terms. All right, these two terms have dy dx's, and these two do not. Okay, I'm going to try to kill two birds with one stone if you'll let me. On the right side, we'd have cosine x minus 6xy, because this term is subtracted to the right. Now, see the two terms in yellow left. So if you don't mind, I'm going to go ahead and factor out the dy dx as common, and inside the parentheses we'd have 3x squared minus 10y. So final answer, dy dx equals cosine x minus 6xy all over 3x squared minus 10y. So that's how we find a derivative for an equation that's defined implicitly. Now, one last thing that you'll notice about this derivative is you traditionally only needed the x to plug in the derivative to find the slope, but now notice we need both the x's and the y's. Now, the reason for that is obvious. If you had an equation defined implicitly, its graph is not going to pass the vertical line test. So if you just provided an x value only, you would not know which of the y values you wanted the slope for, you know, because and they would probably be different answers. If you look at these two different tangent lines, they would be different. So you not only have to provide the x value to the derivative, but you also have to provide the y value as well, just so it knows which one you're talking about.